How do I get my Windows computers to network with each other? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Question I got. Leo, I recently purchased an Asus tablet running Windows, and I've tried just about everything to connect my other Windows machines to this tablet. Both computers are set to use the same workgroup name, namely MS Home, but the tablet asks for a password when I'm setting up the home network. Can you help? Networking is hard. It can be tricky to get set up and get working. It's much trickier than it needs to be, and I've written a couple of articles venting about that in the past. The good news is that I think we can get it to work. I've got several different versions of Windows, and they all talk to each other without too many hiccups. I'm going to walk you through how I set up a Windows machine here that I intend to network with other Windows machines. To be clear, we're talking about file sharing here. Networking encompasses a lot more, but the ability to easily copy files from one computer on your network to another is perhaps the single most valuable use for the average user. On one computer, you create a folder and share it. Then on the other machine, you attempt to connect to, or network to, that folder so you can access the files or place additional files in it from any other network device. So, I will call this a series of steps that I take to stack the deck in my favor. Here's where we start. Number one, make sure both machines are on the same network. Now, I know that this sounds really obvious, but it does need to be said. If you've got more than one router in your system, for example, it's really easy to have more than one network without realizing it. The problem, of course, is that the router's job is to protect what's on one side of the router from what's on the other side of the router. I refer to this as the router acting as a firewall because it's a layer of protection against the wilds of the internet. If you've got a couple of different routers, you may have two different networks, one of them being protected from the other. That means file sharing across the router won't work. Okay, step two. Same workgroup. In settings, just search for the word workgroup. You can see it says change workgroup name. We'll go there. It brings up this old dialog right now. What we need to do is change its domain or workgroup. Click on change. The name of the machine, I'm leaving alone. That's correct. But as it turns out, yeah, this particular virtual machine is on the wrong workgroup for me. So I'm going to change that. I just happen to call my workgroup Notenboom. We'll click on OK. It may take a few seconds, but then eventually, yep, welcome to the Notenboom workgroup. The catch, though, of course, is that, yeah, you're going to need to reboot the machine to make this change stick. So if I hit close, my machine is now going to go ahead and reboot. There's a couple of reasons I use the same workgroup. One, in theory, it makes machines a little bit more visible to one another. In reality, it may not, but it is a way of at least distinguishing all of the computers you have on your network. The other one is that I believe it also makes it ever so slightly more difficult for individuals visiting with their computers connected to my network to actually see all of my machines. I don't want to say it's impossible. This is just something that makes things a little bit easier for me to see or more difficult for them to see. Okay, we're back. And in fact, we will go ahead and check. I'm going to go ahead and go back to the settings app. Search for workgroup once again, just because that's the easiest way to get there. And you'll notice now that the workgroup name is in fact Notenboom. Perfect. That's what I wanted. All right, number three. This is where it gets interesting. I make sure that there's an account on each of my machine with the same specific login name. It doesn't have to be the account that I use to log into the machine. And in fact, it typically isn't. On many of my machines, I log in using my Microsoft account. Well, that's inconvenient for local networking. Instead, I tend to use a local account. Now, the machine we're looking at is actually signed into that local account. You can see that it says Leon local account. That is the account I use on this machine. If you've got a Windows account, if you signed in using a Microsoft account, you can create an additional account on that machine using a consistent name. So for example, on my primary machine where I log in with my Microsoft account, there's also an account called Leon. It's a local machine account. That makes it easier for a machine with an account called Leon to connect to another machine that has that same account called Leon. There's one more piece of magic though. Again, this is anecdotal, but I set up each one of those Leon accounts on each of those machines with the same password. So I could log into my primary machine using Leon with a specific password, and I can log into this machine using Leon with that same password. Again, this makes attempts to connect from one machine to another a little bit easier. Now, we talk about using different passwords everywhere, and this seems kind of like a violation of that. In a sense, it kind of is. But when we're talking about using different passwords everywhere, we're really talking about online, on the web. Here, we've got a handful of machines, all in the same home, all in the same local network. The accounts we're playing with, the passwords we're playing with, have nothing to do with my online world. They are only for these specific machines. Having the same login name and password makes several things easier, and networking is one of them. If, as you're making a connection from one machine to another, you're prompted for a username and password, then you use this username and password that is consistent across all of your machines. Again, it does not have to be your actual Microsoft account or the account you are currently logged in with. All it really needs to be is the local account on the other machine that you're trying to connect to that you've set up with your standard username and password. There's one more thing I want you to do with that one account. Make it administrator capable. That means it has all administrative privileges. Using limited user accounts can add a layer of security for sure, especially if you've got concerns about users on your machine, but using an administrator account, again, makes life just a little bit easier by making those accounts capable of doing just a little bit more. Now, this one's not necessarily obvious, but I want you to, still in the settings app, have a look at network and then have a look at properties. You can see in my case, this says private. These are confusing terms. The other option is public. The difference, what they mean, essentially involves the Windows firewall. If your machine is out in public, then you want to protect it from random connections from the outside. On the other hand, if your machine is in a private environment, like it is on your local network at home, then you can relax some of those firewall rules. One of those rules could easily prevent file sharing, because if you're like out at an internet cafe or a coffee shop, you don't want random people to be able to connect to your machine to grab your files. That's why when you're out and about, that network type should be public. However, if you're at home, as I am, then you want that network type to be private. You're in a private situation. If it's set wrong, how do you change it? This has been an issue for a very long time across Windows versions. I'm going to show you what I believe to be the easiest way to do it. It does involve running Windows PowerShell as administrator. So I'm going to right-click on the Start menu. I'm clicking on Terminal. You might find PowerShell there. Clicking on Yes to the admin prompt. And here I am. I'm in Administrator Windows PowerShell. The command that I'm going to enter is get-netconnectionprofile. This is telling me two important pieces of information. One, the name of this network is network. Not very creative. Your network name may be different, but it's something you'll need if you're going to change the network category. And you'll see here, in my case, network category is set to private. If yours is public and you are at home and you want to make it private, then you would enter a different command. This time we will enter set connection profile dash name network, where the word network in quotes here is replaced by whatever you found in that get network connection profile. Dash network category, private. It's a really boring command, right? It doesn't give you any feedback that it did anything. I'm assuming, of course, if there was an error, you would have seen something. But this will change your network to be private and change the network connection rules in the firewall to make network connections locally that much easier. This might also be a good time to reboot. And I say that because these kinds of settings are sometimes things that are cued to take effect the next time you start the machine. Network connection type seems like a global enough type that it might be one of those that requires a reboot. Obviously, you can check the properties over in settings and even change away from and back to network and internet to see if it is what it was. But if it's still public, even after running this command, then by all means, go ahead and reboot the machine. One more obscure setting. And that's simply to make sure that network discovery is on. The good news here is that you may already have been asked to turn it on as part of trying to make connections. However, you may need to do it yourself. If you need to, that setting is in Network and Internet, Advanced Network Settings, Advanced Sharing Settings, Network Discovery. This is a setting that, as its description implies, allows your machine to be discovered by other machines and allows other machines to be discovered by your machine. Simply make sure that it's on. Now, when it comes down to it, the things that I've mentioned so far, using the same username and password on all of your machines and setting up administrator accounts on all of them, and they're all tiny security issues. That's why I say you're assuming different security in some ways, and that any issues will be small. There are a number of assumptions you can make that are safe if you understand your environment, that being your home. For example, I have, I don't know, probably half a dozen different Windows machines. They're not directly connected to the internet. We're all on a private local network, so all of these private settings, these common accounts, are all very safe to use. If these machines were connected directly to the internet, not through a router, they were not on a local network, but they were all on the internet directly, absolutely, I would be doing none of this. But that's why we have routers. Routers are one way to not just share a single internet connection, but set up that slightly more secure local network on which you can do this. Ultimately, all of these hoops are about finding machines and then authenticating yourself. When you connect from machine A to machine B needs to authenticate you somehow. It needs to confirm that you've got permission to connect to the share you're trying to connect to. How Windows does this is, well, super complicated. Even people who understand networking deeply get confused by all of the different options, the techniques, and the things that happen when those things don't work. Fortunately, your system tends to use your current login credentials on machine A as confirmation that you have permission on machine B. If those same credentials exist on machine B, well, things get easier. Now, I have to throw in one big caveat here at the end. These techniques, as I call them, stacking the deck in favor of success, they work for me. But there aren't any guarantees they'll work for you. Networking, like I've said, is super complicated, and it is certainly possible, if not likely, that other random factors might affect what's going on. And if you're in the situation that I'm really in, don't get me started on cross-platform connectivity, because I've also got Windows, Macs, and Linux machines, and getting them all to talk to one another is always always an exercise in a lot of frustration, sprinkled with a few workarounds and profanity. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/12917. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.